A very good morning to all speakers, delegates and student participants, and a very great welcome to you. My name is Gerhard Litscher and I work at the Medical University of Graz in Austria in Europe. It's a lecture concerning high-tech acupuncture. This is one of the main fields of our research at our medical university of Graz. As you can see in this slide, high-tech acupuncture and integrative medicine is something which is very well known, of course, in Eastern country. It's not practice in our country. Usually Austria, if you hear the name Austria, you can connect it maybe with skiing, with culture, with music, but not so many people know that we have also a little bit research on traditional medicine, and this research I will present you today. Laser, for example, is playing an important role in our acupuncture research, and I will also focus on this topic. But first of all, let me introduce my university with a few slides. It's the Medical University of Graz. Compared to universities in Eastern countries, for example in China, we are a very small university with only few students. You can see here some one of our research center, and we have old buildings, new buildings, and we have also some nice places for relaxing in our campus. Even we are a very small university, we had four Nobel Prize winners in the past, and you see in chemistry and also in medicine. But if you look very close to the date behind the Nobel Prize winner, you can see that this was really in the past. It was many years ago. Well, this is our philosophy. It's the city of Graz, we have old buildings, this is the clock tower, and we have many new buildings, this is the house of art. And what we want to do, even in traditional medicine, we want to combine tradition and innovation. So we have tradition, acupuncture with needles, but we have also modern acupuncture with electro-acupuncture, for example, or laser acupuncture. And you can see here some of our equipment used to measure the effects of acupuncture. And I will go into a little bit into detail tomorrow morning, this morning, how we measure the acupuncture. Let me first introduce some of my staff. This is Professor Wang Lu. She's Chinese. She has studied in Beijing traditional Chinese medicine, but also in Austria Western medicine. So she is now working for more than 15 years in my lab. So she knows both sides very well, Eastern and Western medicine. Here are some other parts from my staff. This is Ingrid Geischek and my daughter Daniela. She has studied pharmacy and is also working on the topic of TCM now at our university. We have many guests. These associate professors, for example, are all from Beijing, and we have many collaboration with different universities in Asia, and they all worked in my lab, for example, between 3 months and 1 year, and we have built up many collaboration with partners from China, but also from other parts of the world I will go into detail with this slide. You can see our research center here and has many connections to China. For example, one of our main partners is the China Academy of Chinese Medical Sciences here in Beijing. And if you only look at the red line here, the red line stands for one joint SCI listed publication we have done together with these institutions. I want to mention also Beijing University of Chinese Medicine or the Western Oriented Capital Medical University here in Beijing. We have cooperations with the Beijing Hospital of Traditional Chinese Medicine, which is affiliated to this Capital Medical University. And I'm very happy that we have also a very good cooperation with the Chinese People Liberation Army General Hospital, the 301 Military Hospital. I will show you some studies afterwards, and also some participants, for example, Dr. Wang Quan from the military hospital is here in this auditorium today. I just, 2 months or 3 months, I came back from Taiwan. I'm also visiting professor at different universities in China and also at China Medical University in Taichung. And I will later introduce Professor Yang from Taipei. He will give the second lecture then here at this meeting. We have also collaboration with the US and here. I want to show you we are doing electro-acupuncture with different hospitals here in the US. Now, this was a short introduction from our Medical University of Graz. I do not need to mention this, but I think it's very important. The number of publications within the last years, for example, in the field only of acupuncture, has increased dramatically. So since the year 2000, you can see here is the PubMed database, you can see a very, very big increase in good papers in journals of acupuncture. Our group is performing acupuncture since many years. We started in 1997 with the acupuncture measurements, and since that we have written many books on these topics. For example, one book, Computer Controlled Acupuncture, which has been written in collaboration with partners from US and Korea, and the Nobel Prize winner, Professor Ernst, has written the preface to this book. Then we have also written some book concerning laser acupuncture, and I will give you some insights into this research. I think I need to mention this in this auditorium, but the brain plays a very, very important role in acupuncture research if we will analyze the effects of acupuncture. Let me have a short look in the past. This was in 1984. This was one of our lab in the intensive care unit. I have to mention that I came from a department of anesthesiology. And when I was a young assistant, I was doing research on brain function monitoring in the operating theater and in the intensive care unit. This is my background. I am from the background biomedical engineer. And one time in 1997, an anesthesiologist came to me and said, "You have so good instrument, let's make a study on acupuncture." I said, "No, please, I am an honorable scientist. I do not want to have anything to do with acupuncture. Please, we are doing another study." Then 14 days ago, he came back to me, "Let's make a little study about acupuncture." I said, "Okay, we are doing a small study and then we will finish." Then I saw all the fascinating changes on our monitor, And I remember very well, 1 month later, I was going to him, please, do you have some patients for acupuncture research? So this was my beginning in 1997. I will show you the instruments. Today, we have more instruments. The instruments are getting smaller, but the number of instruments is increasing. So what we are doing? We are doing mainly manual needle acupuncture stimulation, but we are also laser needle stimulation. I will show you what this means, and we are doing electro-acupuncture. This is our main field. So we are stimulating with different high-tech methods. We have needle, and we have different kinds of lasers. We have, you can see, red, infrared, blue, violet, and we have also the first yellow laser for stimulating. This is very expensive at the moment, but we are doing also research on this topic. Then we have new instruments for electroacupuncture, and we have performed many good studies together with colleagues in China here on this topic. On the other hand, here we have recording procedures. For example, bioengineering assessment. We are recording transcranial Doppler's sonometry, functional fMRI studies. We have different methods for brain function monitoring and also methods for investigating the periphery. For example, changes in the blood flow, velocity, or in the microcirculation. What I want to do this morning is to only show you one example from each group so that you can see, you will become an overview of our research. We are investigating effects in the periphery and also in the brain, the so-called central effects. Let's start with the periphery, with the thermography. You all know thermography. It's like a video camera, and you can record the changes of the temperature, of the surface temperature. Now, what we have done in this experiment, you can see here. We have not inserted a needle, we have used a laser needle. This is a laser beam which is not inserted into the skin, it's only applicated at the skin, and we switch on the laser, and then we are stimulating, for example, the acupuncture point Neiguan for a special time. And we can see with the video camera, with the thermo camera, what happens in the finger, for example. And if you look at the color, you can see the color changes from black to violet. This is an increase in temperature of about 1 to 1.5 degree centigrade. So if you are stimulating this acupuncture point Neiguan, you can see the temperature changes in the hand, in the finger. It's mainly an increase of the temperature. So let's go to the next step. We also want to know about the microcirculation in the skin. Therefore, we have, for example, laser Doppler flow imaging methods or laser Doppler flowmetry for laser for measuring the microcirculation. And you can see another experiment, the same acupuncture point, Neiguan, and we compare this acupuncture point with a so-called placebo point. This is a point which is not lying on a meridian. And what happens, you can see here. This is the tip of the index finger, you can see here. And this happens during needle acupuncture, for example. Here you have the picture from the microcirculation, and you can see the color changes from yellow to blue. This means a decrease of the microcirculation. When you insert a needle into the Neiguan acupuncture point, first the vessels have a vasoconstriction when you insert a needle. This is showing with this decrease, but the interesting thing is 1 or 2 minutes later, the microcirculation increases. This is seen by the red color. These are results from more than 50 healthy volunteers. if you use a so-called placebo point, you also have a decrease from the vasoconstriction of the vessels, but you do not have an increase after 2 minutes or later on. So this is a very good specific proof that acupuncture works specifically. You really must insert the needle into the acupuncture point, make one, otherwise you do not have these effects. Now, you all know these effects in the periphery. Let's go directly to the interesting results we obtained with our neuromonitoring methods. We want to show you the central effects. For that reason, we have constructed such a helmet many years ago. With this helmet constructions, this was investigated for patients in the intensive care unit. I'd mentioned at the beginning, we are measuring also in the intensive care unit in patients, for example, with severe head injury. But no one in the intensive care unit can wear this helmet construction. So the colleague I mentioned before came to me and asked, "You have so good instruments, use it in acupuncture research, and I will show you this first study I mentioned before." With this helmet, we can measure the blood flow velocity within the brain in different arteries, in different arteries, in different depths. We can also measure the oxygen saturation with near-infrared spectroscopy, and we can measure bioelectric effects. All the brain amplifiers, you know this from an EEG machine, are integrated within these electrodes. So we can really measure very sensitive changes in the bioelectrical brain activity. You see, this was our first study. This was the helmet construction in healthy volunteers, and we used a so-called unspecific acupuncture scheme. I think I do not need to pronounce this acupuncture point, Neguan, Qihai, Zuzani, and Saninja. This acupuncture points should make a general increase of qi energy in the brain. And we use this acupuncture schemes, and we saw in our monitors that, for example, the profiles change. This was before, this was during acupuncture, and this was after acupuncture. And you can see the different colors. It changed from yellow to orange. This means an increase in blood flow velocity in the middle cerebral artery. This was a good result, but the people say, okay, it's the pain when you put inside, when you insert the needle, and this is not a specific effect. You can see here some of our research we have done many years ago. We are measuring in different depths. This is a healthy volunteer. Here are some instruments from our group. It was in 1998 that we have performed this investigation. We want to measure also in the ophthalmic artery to see what happens in the ophthalmic artery. We are measuring also ECG. I will come later on the topic heart rate variability. You can see this sensor is for measuring in the middle cerebral artery, and the other sensor is measuring in the ophthalmic artery. These are one of our first results we obtained with our measurement methods. Okay, this was a long time ago. I'm explaining the helmet construction, and I said that I first do not believe in acupuncture, but when I saw the results on our monitor, I changed my mind, and there must be really some effect for our Chinese colleague, it's clear that this point has this effect, but in Western medicine, we have to prove everything with complicated experiments. Okay, then the ophthalmologists came to us and say, okay, you have now an effect in the middle cerebral artery, but it would be very fine to have a specific effect proven that there are special acupoints, for example, which only have influence on the eye, and therefore we build this construction. There we can measure in the middle cerebral artery, in the ophthalmic artery, and also in the supratrochlear artery. And I want to show you this one of the first studies. I think it's important. We used two different acupuncture schemes. One acupuncture scheme, I explained before, which should have a general increase in G energy. This means there is a significant increase in the middle cerebral artery, but we cannot observe any effect in the ophthalmic or supratrochlear artery. And if we use this same healthy volunteers, the same subjects, and we made another acupuncture scheme, for example, an eye acupuncture scheme, then we saw there was a significant increase in the ophthalmic artery, but not in the middle cerebral artery. Though this was really one of the first proof that acupuncture has really a specific effect. If you use this acupuncture scheme, you have this effect in the brain. If you use another one, you have another effect in the brain. And I think this was a really good result we obtained in the past with our measurement procedures. Now, in the meantime, we have performed fMRI studies, for example, in acupuncture research. Here we have painless needles for laser stimulation at different points, and then we got the results in the fMRI. For example, we have effects in the occipital area when we use visual related acupuncture points and so on. All these measurements have been proven by other groups also in the meantime. As I told you at the beginning, I will only show you one result to each measurement method. Another method is, for example, the near infrared spectroscopy. With this method, we can measure the changes in the blood oxygen in the brain on a non-invasive way. And you can see we have so-called optodes. This means optical electrodes. We put this on the skull, and then we can see the reflected signal, and we can see the changes in the oxygen metabolism. This is a very new system also for the NIRS measurement. It's a unique system only available at our university, and you can see we can measure also in children, and this was our hypothesis. We thought that when we use a metal needle, we have a significant effect when we insert the needle. If you use the laser, we have a reaction like a plateau. It needs some time when we switch on the laser to have an effect. And these are real measured data. You can see this effect and the effect of laser acupuncture. Now let's go to the bioelectrical methods. Again, two different acupuncture schemes. For example, an acupuncture scheme for sedation. We use the point Intang, we use Shenting, and also other points, Shenmen, to have effects on bioelectrical signals which are decreasing, which are relaxing. And we have these measurements performed with needles and also with lasers on the same points. And what you can see here is the effects in the brain. The effects of the EEG, of the bioelectrical brain activity, measured with a monitor. When we use the sedation scheme and we use a sedation monitor, we use another acupuncture scheme, we have no effects. But when we use the sedation scheme, we have a significant decrease in the monitor, for example, in the state entropy or in the response entropy. And these are the results from the needle acupuncture. And if we use the same acupuncture point and we are stimulating with laser, you can see in the next slide the effects are similar. So we do not need to penetrate the skin. We can also stimulate with a, for example, red laser, which has a penetration depth of, for example, 3 centimeters. I think that's a very good example. You can see with needles and nearly similar effects with lasers. Now, this was the reason why we called one of our study high-tech laser acupuncture is Chinese medicine. I will explain you this title, because in the past we always used laser. We are stimulating, for example, 20 seconds on one point, and then we go to the next point and are stimulating 20 seconds. Nobody in China will insert needles for 20 seconds in one point, then remove the needle, then go to the next point. They always stimulating an acupuncture scheme. And this is what we can do with our machine. We can stimulate simultaneously many acupuncture points and stimulate continuously also for 20 or 30 minutes an acupuncture scheme. So this is very similar to traditional Chinese medicine. This is why we call this title high-tech acupuncture is. We have also investigations in animals, and we have many corporations, as I told you before, with different parts in China, from Harbin, from the north of China to the south, to Wuhan and Shanghai. We are exchanging data. I will show you later. Of course, OMICS Group has very good publications, and we are publishing also in OMICS Group. We have also other journals, for example, evidence-based complementary medicine, which has a high impact factor. I'm editor of 18 of these special issues of ECAM, and you can see it's traditional medicine in the world, or it's high-tech acupuncture and integrative laser medicine, and different kinds. This is another journal, Integrative Medicine International, and I'm also responsible for medicines, for example, in journal which also publishes traditional medicine. Now let's have a short look on the scientific overview of laser acupuncture. You know, if you search in the PubMed, laser and acupuncture, you will find many articles. But if you search for laser acupuncture, you will only find 700 articles up to now, and 65 are from our research group in Graz. So I think there is a lot of things to do in laser acupuncture. I know very well that in China, laser is no topic. Yes, if you ask a patient, would you be treated by needle acupuncture or by laser, the decision is clear. He wanted to be treated by a needle acupuncture, yes, of course. But this has also been to do with, in people China, for example, and you know this very well, they want to feel the qi sensation. Yes, they ask the doctor, please give more stimulation or something like this. In our country or in Europe, it must be painless. Yes, the best method is that the patient do not feel the stimulation. Many people in Europe are afraid of needles. They like laser because it's non-invasive. I have to mention this. I know this very well. But on the other side, it gives us a very good research tool, the laser, because if you do not feel the stimulation, it's possible for the first time to make double-blind studies. This is not possible with acupuncture research. With laser, we have done many of these double-blind studies, and we can prove also some effects which are the same for needle acupuncture or in children. I think it's very good in Western world children to treat with laser acupuncture, for example. So I told you we have many different kinds of lasers. red laser, infrared laser. We have also blue laser, and the blue laser is also a special kind of laser with which you can have a very good Qi sensation. The penetration of the blue laser is not very deep. It's only 1 to 2 millimeters, but you can feel it. You can feel the heat of the laser. You can feel an electrical feeling similar to a Qi sensation in needle acupuncture. That's why also people in China like the blue or violet laser, because they can feel this laser and they can feel the Qi sensation. Now in my second part, this was a general overview of what we have done in the past. I will summarize one of our latest studies we have done, and I will only show you the title page of the articles we have published, so that you can see a little bit what we have published in the last time. Yes, there is the Qi sensation in laser acupuncture. This was one study we have done also in evidence-based complementary medicine. Some groups have shown that you can also have a very good Qi sensation with laser acupuncture. This was not clear in the past. Then we have summarized the different parts of the technical parameters with laser. At the moment, it's a question nobody knows: how much must be the doses for laser? How long do you have to treat? How strong must be the intensity? We have made several studies on this topic, and we have seen that sometimes more intensity does not mean to have more effects. Sometimes there is a little bit less intensity better than a very high intensity. We have made studies about the penetration depth of the laser, and you can see here the different kinds of laser from violet to red and yellow. This was a study done in my lab with the violet laser. We have a laser needle here at the point Dajui, and we have measured in the basilar artery the blood flow velocity. This is not easy. If you have tried by yourself, it's very complicated to measure in the basilar artery over a period of a longer time, and we have to make some equipment here to measure these effects. You can see here, this has been done by a colleague from Beijing. The needle is very deep here, and we have compared our laser machine with needle stimulation, and here you can see the results. We have an increase in the blood flow velocity in the basilar artery with the violet laser, but the effect is more pronounced with the metal needle and with the so-called placebo. We switched off the laser, we have no effect. Then we have performed measurements with the violet laser acupuncture on the human arterial stiffness or on the microcirculation. I will only show you here some picture on this topic. We always saw that the laser has specific effects, but the effects maybe are more pronounced with needles than with laser. This was a study on the temperature distribution. This was the same point, Dajui, and we measured with thermal imaging, and you can see the heat here from this violet laser, the distribution of the heat. The red color shows that the heat is here more pronounced, and it's interesting that also when you're stimulating this point Dajui on other parts, there is an increase in the heat on the back. Then we have many studies on heart rate variability. You know the ECG very well, and the distances of the ECG can be calculated, and then you have the heart rate variability. And Professor Han Yicheng from Beijing, from Peking University, from the Institute of Neuroscience. I met him several times in China, and he is well known, of course, in China and also in Europe very well. And he is just to very short summarize, he is the father of the electro-acupuncture. He has found differences between different frequencies, that different frequencies has different effects. And he said to me, you are using laser, try to use also different effects with laser stimulation. Maybe you got different effects, and we have done such a study. This was at the physiology conference in Suzhou, I think 1 or 2 years ago. And we have made these studies with 2 hertz and 100 hertz, also with laser, and we found indeed different results when we use this non-invasive laser. You can see the decrease of the heart rate was more pronounced when we used 2 hertz than 100 hertz. Though this was also the next step forward in our laser acupuncture research. Of course, we are doing also research in animals. You can see here rat experiments with the laser. This is our heart rate monitor. We are measuring heart rate from rat and stimulating at Baihui, for example, here at the brain, rat brain. We are analyzing this. This studies has been performed in Germany, in Mannheim, but also here in Beijing. You can see the different stimulations at the rat, the different changes in temperature. I do not want to go into detail, and we are investigating also the different frequencies, the different acupoints. We are doing this in basic in animal studies, and also, as you can see here, then in human experimental studies, the same acupoints performed in my lab in Graz. So I will come very quickly to one of the last topic, to heart rate variability. I will show you what we understand when we are performing teleacupuncture. Teleacupuncture, for example, we have done this with heart rate variability, and we are exchanging data with different institutions in China. This means we are sending data for more than many thousands of kilometers. In just 10 years ago, it was a vision I had, but it was not clear that this could really work. Yes, I could not believe this, but today we are exchanging data via internet connections, and it works very well. And this was, I think, a very, very good improvement for our research. Well, let's come to heart rate variability. I do not need to explain in detail what this means. You see the heart, you have the ECG intervals, and you can have some effects in the brain, or the heart rate variability is also modulated from the lower brainstem. Yes, to say it very in a very simple way. This old Chinese scientist, Wang Shuhe, he stated, if the pattern of the heartbeat becomes regular as the tapping of the woodpecker or the dripping of the rain from the roof, the patient will be dead in 4 days. Well, in our intensive care unit, we used sophisticated monitors. We have made many, many investigations with statistical analysis, and we saw the same conclusion with that a comatose patient, for example, when he has a very, very regular heart beat, has a bad outcome and he will die. This ancient scientist has no monitors. The only thing he had was his fingers, and he was doing this, and he came to the same conclusion with his pulse diagnosis, but we have to prove this with complicated, sophisticated statistical analysis. And we can analysis heart rate variability in different ways. As you can see here, we can have influences from sympathicus and parasympathicus. We can separate these effects. Heart rate variability is, of course, of course, age-related dependent. This means with increasing age, heart rate variability decreases. You can see some investigations we have made in infants with 6 weeks, 6 months, 1 year, it increases, but then with age it decreases. These are the sophisticated statistical we used in our COMETIS patients. This was a paper from 1987 in functional neurology, and this is also a diagram from the intensive care unit with different signals. We can make correlations between different signals in the brain. We can investigate interaction between the brain. But for TCM, we have now a very good analysis technique. We call it the fire of life technique. What does this mean? We are graphically representing the heart rate variability in this way. We have 24 hours, for example, here, and here are the different frequency. And here you can see in a healthy adult, these are 24 hours, and you can see the sleep-wake cycle here. This is the night, this is the sleep, very well. If a patient has chronic stress, if he is not in a good condition, you can see the fire of life does not burn so much as in a healthy volunteer. And if you have a burnout syndrome, for example, there is no fire burning. The patient has much stress and the heart rate variability is very regular. You do not see these effects. This was our first teleacupuncture made with China Academy of Chinese Medical Sciences. You can see it was a patient with chronic stress. Here you can see the Chinese diagnosis, burnout syndrome, and this was made in Beijing, and the data were sent to our lab, and we have gave response to the acupuncture colleagues in Beijing immediately. Only the time delay does play a role now in our investigations. And you can see they have done acupuncture, and you can see what happens after the fourth treatment. After the fourth treatment, we have a clearly sleep-wake cycle. This was not at the beginning. And after the 10th acupuncture treatment, this sleep-wake cycle was very good. So the conclusions of this teleacupuncture study, HRV is a very good indicator of the state of health. It's less random with the aging process and age-related diseases, and you can counteract using different preventive methods like acupuncture or, of course, herbal medicine or other traditional medicines. Now, for the very last part of my presentation, just to let you see what we are doing, our latest investigations, we are doing clinical research in human clinical studies, burnout, insomnia. This was one paper we have published together with the Heyuan-Chang University in Harbin with the neurological department. This was a paper concerning burnout and depression, also with the same department. Then we have also basic research on laser acupuncture. One paper I want to especially mention because Dr. Wang Quan has made many investigations here at the 301 Military Hospital with a new method on electro-acupuncture. And we have shown for the first time that electroacupuncture can significantly improve heart rate variability and all the clinical score in patients with depressions. I want to show you very briefly this electroacupuncture system. We call it electroacupuncture to go. What does this mean? The patient can come to the acupuncture clinic. He becomes the electroacupuncture system behind the ear, and here a sensor and batteries are integrated, and they are stimulating electrically ear points. And the patient can go home, and he can come back after 1, 2, or 3 days to the clinic, and we can see the improvement of this electroacupuncture. It's computer controlled, so for example that you have 20 minutes stimulation, it's a very low electrical stimulation, so it's not painful, but I think it's a very good opportunity to make here some electroacupuncture continuously. This was another study together with Professor Liu Zunqi from the Capital Medical University, from the Beijing Hospital affiliate of TCM affiliated to Capital Medical University. And this was a study performed at our university in newborns. You can see in newborns we are also using this laser methods. We have some research articles, review articles concerning ear acupuncture. In 2016, we will have the World Congress of Ear Acupuncture in our capital, Vienna, in Austria. This was one of this topic. A topic we are performing now together with China Academy of Chinese Medical Sciences and also with Harbin is the lateralization of acupuncture points. There are not so many papers concerning lateralization of acupuncture points. I think this is also an interesting topic and we are doing research on this topic. I will not go into details in all these other studies. We can also stimulate with laser intravenously, for example. We have done these studies here in Beijing. We can do it in human with intravenous laser stimulation, and some of these results are summarized in a book called High-Tech Acupuncture and Integrative Medicine. We have developed, for example, also a system for measuring the skin impedance for acupuncture point. You know, some researchers say at the acupuncture point, the impedance, the skin impedance is increased. But some researchers say it's decreased. So what really happens at the acupuncture point? And for that reason, we have developed this instrument. You can see in the middle of this measurement system, you can insert a needle here in the middle of this instrument, and then you can measure the changes at the different localizations of the skin so that you can see if there is any special direction where the skin impedance changes. I think this is also important for meridian research, for example, and it could give new insights into meridian research. With our method, we found out that the skin impedance is lower at an acupuncture point than at a placebo point. Then I told it at the beginning, we have a 50-channel near system, and we have done many investigations also on this topic. This is electroacupuncture. We are measuring the electroacupuncture effects on different brain. You can see here the preparation of the patients. We are also doing EEG mapping. In our lab, you can see the preparation of this EEG system is very time consuming. It needs about 1.5 hours to prepare the student or to prepare the patient for the measurement. But I think also these basic investigations are very important and are absolutely necessary for our research in acupuncture. This is an interesting result concerning laser acupuncture. This patient or volunteer is sitting, he is looking on the screen, he has open eyes, and he is stimulating at the point neguan with laser acupuncture. And we can show you what happens in the brain. If you can see this laser stimulation, you have a visual evoked potential over the occipital area. But it's very interesting. If you cannot feel the stimulation, and if you cannot see the stimulation, you have also evoked potentials which you can record over the central region. Now that's very interesting. You can stimulate near the median nerve with an optical stimulus, and you get an electrical response in the brain. Though nobody knows at the moment how the optical stimulus is transferred into the electrical signals, but it shows that laser works, and I think our study can show these effects very clear, but at the moment we cannot explain the underlying mechanism, but I think we have to do one step after another. I told you we have also yellow lasers. Yellow laser is a very new development, and we have the first yellow laser at our medical university for medical purposes, and we are doing also some research on this topic. It's very interesting, and I think I have to finish my lecture. It's very interesting. The lasers can penetrate the skull, and the laser can go inside into the brain. This opens up a very new field for stimulation in many diseases, neurological diseases, depression, or other diseases. So I had a very long talk, so my conclusion will be, of course, very short. I hope I can could give you some insights into our research at Medical University of Graz. I have shown you some aspects concerning modernization of acupuncture, high-tech acupuncture network. You know, you remember the different connections to the different universities. I tried to explain a little bit about teleacupuncture, high-tech ear acupuncture, red and infrared laser. Of course, there is no time to go into the detail, but I want to thank many of these institutions. We have been supported by Sino-Austrian collaborations, by the ministries, two ministries in Austria, the ministries of science, economy and research, and the ministry of health in Austria, and also in China by the ministry, different ministries, and Eurasia Pacific Uninet plays also an important role in this collaboration between China and Austria. Last but not least, at our website you can get the latest information at Litscher Info or Litscher Biz. And by the way, this is our from our region, our logo. It's a panther. It's called the Styrian panther. We call it the Styrian dragon. So there is also a relationship to China. And I want to say in German, danke schön, thank you, tschüssi. Thank you very much. And here you can see some of the collaboration partners. Okay, it's... I do not know if we have time for some question, maybe one short question. The organizers say yes, okay. Or two, okay. That's a very good topic, and I think I can talk about this 1 or 2 hours. To the best of my knowledge, of course, there was, I know all the research concerning meridians. We were not possible with our equipment to visualize the meridian systems, nor in animals, nor in humans. To the best of my knowledge, there are very good experiments also, I'm thinking about, of Korea and China and many different parts. But to the best of my knowledge, it's not possible at the moment to visualize meridians. This is a very short statement, but I can give you further explanations. There was a German group. They said, okay, we can visualize the viridians with thermography. We have all the instruments and we try to do the same, but we cannot do this. We saw that these were optical artifacts. It was not possible. You cannot visualize with thermography, for example, the meridians at the moment. Nevertheless, that does not mean that meridians does not exist, okay? But I think we have to go another way with, to my opinion, it will not be possible with thermography to visualize meridians alone. I think I mentioned only very briefly one aspect, for example, the changes in the impedance could be another possibility or something like this.
I'd have to make a very short comment concerning your and also the wonderful lecture. So this may cost me about 3 or 4 minutes, but I'll take it off from my talk. There is, I think we can visualize the meridian in terms of lymphatic tissues, not neuron tissues. The reason I'll give it in my talk is because the inflammatory activities and the stimuli and also what Gephardt just mentioned.
He kept a mail to us.
Acupuncture, I think, can be interpreted. I'm an outsider,
he's not
but coming. I'm willing
yes.
to share
but he kept a mail that
with you my crazy ideas. Because I just came back from the United States.
Live
now there's realized placebo effects for many
these
of the drugs. And I'll tell a story later.
Yeah. Okay.
That impact upon your belief and your understanding, your cognition, and recognition. Therefore, if there is a pain or there is a stress which people understand is coming or expecting, then you will have an effect. But animals don't do that. Animals do not understand that there may be something going on because they are not trained. All right. So that could, and why the lymphatic system, I'll do that later, because any small wound can include an inflammatory activity which can transmit messages, okay, which can actually, there's now so-called immune synapses, which can connect to other tissues. Therefore, it doesn't have to be at the exact point. It has to be in the surrounding areas, okay? So the lymphokines, cytokines can transmit. This is may be all bullshit, but I think we may want to think about it, okay? That's my comments.
Thank you very much for the I'm very short, please, because the organizer told me some change.
I'm very much short in the pinpointing. You have listened very good, very enlightened lecture from you, but I have not seen any when you stated about this safety studies along with this clinical and pre-clinical studies in humans.
Yes, you are totally right. Time was too short. I did not give any comments about the safety of the laser. That's really another point I have to point out. To my opinion, laser is very safe. Of course, the direct stimulation in the eye is very dangerous. You are totally right. But I think this will be another lecture to give about the safety of the laser. I want to mention, please be careful when you use the laser for stimulating eye points. In the periphery, it's totally okay.